I see artificial intelligence as a very important part of computer science. Of course, it has a lot of connections to cognitive science, and there are two approaches, the cognitive approach and the engineering approach. I think FBK and DFKI share the belief that we are more in the engineering approach. That means we want to build computers who exhibit behavior which we would call intelligent if done by humans. One of the most important factors for really having impact, both societal impact and also industrial impact, is to have a good ecosystem around an institute like you have it here at FBK. It needs some time, but I think you have to find very good industrial partners, big companies on the one hand side, but also around these big companies are a lot of spin-off and small and medium enterprises which work on a common goal. One example would be manufacturing, you know. Second example is automotive, new types of cars, energy systems, and so on. And I think in Europe we are pretty strong in such clusters of innovations, because it's very common in Europe that industry and academia work together. It has a longer tradition than in the US, for instance, or in Asia. I think in the global market, of course, big companies, which are internet companies, always the same, you know, in US you mentioned, for instance, Amazon, Google, this is consumer oriented. And in Europe we are pretty weak on this. In Europe our ecosystem is based much more on producing physical objects. And I think that we are very good in injecting artificial intelligence in the physical products we are producing in Europe, and they are still the best. In Germany we have our cars, we have very good appliances, better washing machines. You don't get such machines in the United States. We have a very good harvesting machine in agricultural technology. We have extremely good medical equipment, and our idea is more to bring AI into these physical systems and not to go on the internet, which is consumer-based. Because in Europe we have a disadvantage. We have a very fragmented digital market. This is the language barrier on the one hand, but also the different cultures, which is nice about Europe, but it's very hard to launch a product. If you go in China, you have millions and millions of people, you know, even in the city of Beijing, 22 million inhabitants. We don't have some of our states like Finland have only 7 million people, and you have to adapt to the Finnish language. So this is a handicap. So it's better to stick with physical goods and inject the artificial intelligence there, and that's what we are doing very successfully. I think the global companies recognize more and more the importance of AI for innovation of their own company, of their products, but also of their production processes, internal organization. So I don't know any big global company which has no AI department information. That more and more big companies have very attractive positions for AI researchers. So we will, as public institutions, will have a hard time to retain our best talents at the institutions, because of course the salary is much better in these industrial labs. And the more there are really top-notch research conditions, people have the tendency to move. For instance, in my own institution, DFKI, most of the researchers get every week offers from institutions, especially global companies, worldwide. And I have a hard time to convince them they should stay with us. Many people are a little bit frightened that things like Industry 4.0, that means intelligent manufacturing based on AI technology, could cut a lot of work for humans so that they lose their job. But the contrary is the case. We observe that the countries who have most of the robots in Europe and most of advanced technology manufacturing have less jobless than ones who have no robots. So it's the inverse. Why? Because the tendency in manufacturing is to do onshoring. Things which were produced in low-wage countries, especially in Asia, think about Thailand, Malaysia, are now coming back. Why? Because Industry 4.0 is about so-called mass customization. You want to configure your own sports shoe by Adidas on your laptop, but then you don't want to wait for 4 weeks until it comes from Malaysia, but it should be right there in 2 or 1 day. And this means the manufacturing has to be very close to the consumer, and this means factories come back. In Germany, for instance, Adidas, the shoe company, has just opened 2 new factories in Germany, not in Malaysia, because of this trend. So I think it brings back more occupation, actually. For workers, I think these systems, if they are well designed, can be a relief, because the system really is an assistant to the human worker. We are not talking about human-less factories, but these are factories where robots and humans work hand in hand. I think one concrete goal which I'm following is that through Industry 4.0 and smart factories, we are able to have zero emission factories in the middle of the city. Because for a long time, we call this urban production, we had the big problem that most of the big factories was outside the city where people lived. So even when the factories get cleaner and cleaner and cleaner, green factory, but still there is a commuting between the people where they live and where they work. And what we want to do with AI is to have smart factories which you can have directly in the residential area, so that people, like in 1800, can actually walk or use their bicycle to go to work, saving CO2. Because it doesn't make sense to have a factory which have a CO2 level of zero, but then, you know, the car traffic to the factory is the factor. Therefore, we work on this, and this needs AI, because only with AI you can do intelligent resource management in a factory, so that actually the resource waste is put to a minimum.